بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
A presentation of Quran Sunnah educational programs. Visit us online at www.qsep.com.
واتقوا فتنة لا تصيبن الذين ظلموا منكم خاصة.
Islamic principles for the Muslims' attitude during Fitan.
الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما. The subject that has been shown or that has been chosen by the brothers to be the topic of this seminar is actually the topic of the hour, and it is a very important subject, because it is about the afflictions. And the afflictions are abnormal troubles that occur, and the Muslim has to be fully aware what to do and how to behave in those times of abnormality. The fitna will be explained, inshallah, during the answers for the questions. Regarding the Sheikh Salih al-Sheikh, the name al-Sheikh usually means the descendants of Sheikh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah. Like the Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia, Samahatu Sheikh Abdul Aziz Al Sheikh. He is one of the descendants of Sheikh al Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. And like the Minister of the Religious Affairs in Saudi, who is the author of the book, Sheikh Salih Al Sheikh. And Sheikh Salih has been recognized to be one of the brilliant scholars in this age. I remember some of the quotations of the great scholars acknowledging him as a scholar, like a statement by Samahatu Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, and other scholars. I had the honor to be the chairman for introducing him in a lecture when I was the head of Quran and Sunnah organization in the mid-80s, and his lecture was regarding the da'wah of Sheikh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah. And he is, mashallah, a well-established scholar. In his writings, in his tapes, I advise every Muslim who knows Arabic to go and listen to this great Sheikh and to benefit a lot from him. The scholars benefit you knowledge-wise. They give you knowledge that you feel you got. Unlike those who speak to remind people and to strengthen their faith, they benefit you by their way of talking and by their enthusiasm sometimes and things like that. They benefit you in a way, to increase your faith momentarily and things like that. But knowledge is the real increaser of faith. Knowledge, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I have not created the jinn and humans, but to worship me. إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ One of the scholars said, إِلَّا لِيَعْرِفُونَ But to know me. Why? Because you cannot be worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the right way without knowing Him in the right way. And you cannot know Him in the right way except by seeking the knowledge from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because this is knowledge. We, the Salafis, when we say knowledge, we mean the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And guaranteed by the understanding of our predecessors, the companions, and those who followed their footsteps in the right way. This is the meaning of Salafiyya, because as-Salaf means the predecessors, the ones who have passed. And the foundation of the Salaf are the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they are, the Salaf are the Jama'ah, the group, or the congregation that we belong to. They are the Jama'ah. As Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, said, Al-Jama'atu hum ahlu al-ilmi wal-fiqh. Al-Jama'atu hum ahlu al-ilmi wal-fiqh. And a same statement was made before Imam al-Bukhari by the great pious mujahid and scholar of hadith, Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, rahimahullah. Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, Imam al-Shafi'i, when he described him, he said he was an imam in hadith. And then he said he was an imam in sunnah. And then he said he was an imam in fiqh. And then he said he was an imam in wara', piousness. And then he said he was an imam in zuhd. And he mentioned, and jihad, and so on. He mentioned 9 things. Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, rahimahullah, was asked, who is the jama'ah? Who is the group? We say in our prayer, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم The path of those whom you have bestowed your favor upon. These are the jama'ah. So he said, Al-jama'atu Abu Bakr wa Umar. Meaning the companions. Not meaning exclusively Abu Bakr and Umar. No, meaning the companions. They said, but Abu Bakr and Umar have passed away. Then he mentioned 2 of the students of the companions, Tabi'een. They said, but they passed away as well. He added, saying, Abu Hamza, al-Sukari, a pious scholar who was in his time. Of course, he was very humble. He didn't say me. He was very humble, even though he was yani, the head in his time. And everyone was considering him to be the head of the scholars. But he mentioned another scholar in his time. So the meaning of what Abdullah al-Mubarak has said is the same as what Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah said. Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak mentioned the scholars of every age. And not just any scholars, but the scholars who have the knowledge, the full knowledge, the right knowledge of Quran and Sunnah. Because those names, Abu Bakr and Umar, and the names of their students and so on, they never learned any philosophy or any knowledge of the kalam, the talk, and all that. No. All they learned was the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And similarly, Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, when he was asked, who are the group? He said, Ahlul Hadith. Ahlul Hadith. And by Hadith, he means the knowledge which is based on Hadith, based on Sunnah, based on the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's what our predecessors meant by the name Sunnah, when they said Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak is an imam in Hadith, and then they said he is an imam in Sunnah. Someone might say, isn't Sunnah the Hadith? Yes, indeed. But by Sunnah, they meant the fundamentals of faith, the fundamentals of belief. And those fundamentals have to be from Sunnah. Otherwise, they will not be the right fundamentals. If they are not from Sunnah, then they are not the right fundamentals. Also, Imam Yazid ibn Harun before Imam Ahmad, and Yahya ibn Sanan before Imam Ahmad, and Sufyan before Imam Ahmad, they all explained the jama'ah or the group to be the scholars of Hadith, the scholars of Sunnah. And this is also the meaning of the Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا تزال طائفة من أمتي ظاهرين على الحق لا يضرهم من خالفهم حتى يأتي أمر الله. That a group amongst my nation will still be victorious upon the truth, on the truth, until the order of Allah comes. Meaning the day of judgment or the last signs of the day of judgment. Imam al-Bukhari said, At-Ta'ifa, the group, means Ahlul Ilmi wal-Fiqh. Just like he said in Al-Jama'a. When he explained Al-Jama'a in the Hadith, he said, Hum Ahlul Ilmi wal-Fiqh. And when he explained At-Ta'ifa, in this hadith, he said, Hum Ahlul Ilmi wal Fiqh. Imam Ahmad, the same, he did the same thing. He said, Hum Ahlul Hadith. And he said, In lam yakunu Ahlul Hadith, fala adri man hum. If they were not Ahlul Hadith, the scholars of Sunnah, then I don't think there is anyone who is worthy of this title. And the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that a group will be remaining on the truth, meaning the scholars, this by itself is the greatest solution of all afflictions. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is hinting to you, a very strong hint, that they are the ones to reach in times of afflictions. They are the ones to go to. They are the reference. And we will see, inshallah, why this is true. We will see it clearly, inshallah.
Warning against fitna. Fitan causes the intellect to depart. By Sheikh Hamoud Ibn Abdullah At-Tuwayjiri. Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu said, alcohol is not more effective in causing the intellect of men to depart than fitna. Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu said, there will be fitna in which the intellect of man will be distorted such that you will hardly see a rational man. Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu said, there will be fitna, then after that there will be jama'ah, then there will be fitna, after which there will be no jama'ah. Voices will be raised then, the eyes will stare in horror, intellect will depart, and you will hardly see a rational man. Ibn Masud radiallahu anhu said, I fear for you a fitna, which is like night, in which the heart of a man dies just like his body dies. Sheikh Saleh bin Abdul Aziz Ali Sheikh writes, O brothers, seek refuge in Allah from all kinds of fitan. Seek refuge in Allah from the fitan that might burn your deen, your thinking, your body, and every good. Seek refuge in Allah, for there is never any good in fitan. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to frequently seek refuge with Allah from fitan, and he used to warn against fitan. Therefore, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah began the book of fitan in his Sahih al-Bukhari with the following chapter, the saying of Allah, fear the fitna which affects not only those of you who do wrong, and the warning of Allah's Messenger against fitan. Such is because when fitan arises, it does not only seize the unjust, rather it afflicts everyone. Moreover, when it arises, it does not spare anyone to say anything. So it is necessary for us to warn ourselves and others against fitan before it arises and stay far away from anything that might take us close to or lead to fitan. Verily, increase in the emergence of fitan is from amongst the signs of the final days. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, time will pass rapidly, good deeds will decrease, miserliness will be thrown in the hearts of the people, fitan will appear and there will be much al-harj. The Sahaba asked, O Messenger of Allah, what is al-harj? The Prophet replied, killing. Fitan is amongst the signs of the final days, because when fitan arises, it brings about destruction, corruption, which will be a sign of the approach of the hour.
In the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the word fitna is mentioned, and it means shirk. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Let those who intend to act different from the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, let them be aware of two great evils. The first and the worst is the fitna, affliction. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah said, أَتَدْرِي مَا الْفِتْنَةِ? In this verse, يعني, do you know what is fitna? الْفِتْنَةُ الشِّرْكِ. Fitna means that your punishment will be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will switch your heart from faith in His oneness to shirk. What a great punishment. What a great punishment. This is the greatest punishment. Because if you die on that state, that's it. You have nothing in the hereafter. Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, before Imam Ahmad, said, Al-fitna al-tab'u ala al-qulub, to seal the heart, which is very close to the same meaning that Imam Ahmad gave. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Muslims, when they become strong enough, He said, قَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةً. Fight the mushrikeen so that will remain no fitna, meaning no shirk. Wipe out the shirk when you can. When you can. So this is the meaning of this word fitna in those two verses. Shirk, great shirk. And fitna also means sometimes the vagueness of the situation. You don't know whether this action is the right thing or not. You don't know the outcomes, whether they are going to turn for the good of Muslims or for the worst, for the better of Muslims or for the worst. That's why Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, وَأَيُّمَا قِتَالٍ لَمْ تَتَرَجَّحْ مَفْسَدَتُهُ مِنْ مَصْلَحَتِهِ فَهُوَ قِتَالُ فِتْنَةٍ يَحْرُمْ الدُّخُولُ فِيهِ. That in case you are about to indulge in a certain fighting, but you're not sure of the outcomes. You are not sure of the outcomes. Whether the outcomes are going to be for the better of Muslims or for the worst. He says, in this case, this is qitalu fitna. It is haram to indulge in it. You have to stop. That's why most of the companions did not indulge in the fighting between, for example, Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah, or between Ali radiallahu anhu and Aisha and Ibn Umar and the other companions. Most of them did not indulge, especially the companions who fought in the Battle of Badr, who have a much higher rank amongst the companions. Maybe one or two companions who fought in the Battle of Badr only indulged. Okay. So if this is a fighting of fitna in which you're not sure whether the evil is more or the good is more, then how about when you are sure that the evil is going to be more and the Muslims, as a result of your fighting, will suffer more than they were and will fall into a lot of losses and for no felt victory or good results, then this is worse of a fitna than the first one, because the first one you are not sure, but here you are sure, or at least most probably, that if we go and do this now, the results will be more evil. And unfortunately, nowadays, they call this second type jihad. It's not jihad. It's not jihad. The Prophet ﷺ defined jihad. He said, "Man qatala litakuna kalimatullahi hiya al-ulya fahuwa fi sabilillah." Who is to decide better than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He said, he who fights so that the end result will be that the word of Allah becomes higher, becomes stronger. Islam becomes victorious. Muslims become more powerful, more victorious. They gain a lot. We are not saying that jihad means, or we're not saying that no Muslims should be killed. Why did Allah make jihad a good action? Jihad involves killing. But for what? For what? You see? This is the point. And I'm not saying this out of empty imagination. No, I'm saying this from what I see and what I hear in the name of jihad nowadays. Look around you, Iraq, Afghanistan, here and there. Look what happened, you see. I remember hearing a tape by one of the so-called leaders of jihad nowadays. He was cussing the great scholars of Saudi Arabia. This was back in the 90s. Because he claimed that they make the youth less interested in jihad by telling them, you have to be careful who to fight with and what cause to fight with, and you have to weigh the outcomes, the good and evil and things like that. He said, who knows the outcome? I don't know the outcome, he says. Sometimes I make dua, I ask Allah for something, and it turns out to be bad for me. So who is to say what is the advantage and disadvantage? Okay. As if advantages and disadvantages fall under the category of the knowledge of the ghaib and seen. No, it's not from this. It's not from this. It's from what the scholars use their mind and their knowledge and weigh the situation. You can do this. This is not from the ghaib. You see, we don't know the ghaib. We don't know the unseen. But he was making this from this category. And then he said a very stupid statement. He said, no one knows the maslaha, the advantages. Even Prophet Muhammad did not know that. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. This is the most stupid statement. And this statement is a kind of slander for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he did not know. So otherwise he would be a kafir, by saying this. How could you say that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam just orders the people to fight regardless of the outcomes? A'udhu billah. What is this? You see? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the beginning of Islam in Mecca, when the youth Muslims used to suffer on the hands of the mushriks so much torture, and they lose their wealth and a lot of things. And they came to the Prophet ﷺ seeking permission for them to fight. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse, كُفُّوا أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Hold back your hands. Don't fight. And do what is obligatory on you now, and that is salat, prayers. You see. And this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see. And if you say this now to them, they say, oh, we know who you are. You are one of the hypocrites, the puppets of governments and things like that. So the word fitna could mean also, as I mentioned, the vagueness in the situation. The vagueness in the situation. Also the word fitna means the afflictions. The afflictions, all afflictions can fall under fitna. And it could be a punishment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now,
Sheikh Saleh bin Abdulaziz al-Sheikh quoted Allama Alusi rahimahullah concerning the verse, fear the fitna which affects not only those of you who do wrong, but it may afflict everybody. Allama Alusi explained, the fitan mentioned in the saying of Allah has many explanations, one amongst which is compromise, negligence in ordering the good and forbidding the evil at the appearance of innovation. What is meant by compromise, negligence in ordering the good and forbidding the evil at the appearance of innovation?
As I mentioned earlier, that fitna could mean a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do something which displeases Allah, and you continue doing it without repentance, you become more arrogant, then Allah will punish you with something. We mentioned some forms of punishment. That is, first, fitna could mean shirk or sealing the heart, which is the greatest punishment actually one can suffer. And the Sheikh here explains the fitna by other examples of punishments. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you amongst those who will not care to order the good and forbid the evil. Because Allah guides whom He wills and misguides whom He wills. And therefore, this will be a punishment that you don't feel like to do this great obligation. You know that ordering the good and forbidding the evil was one of the greatest qualities that Allah mentioned describing the companions, radiallahu anhu. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. You were the best of generations that were brought out to mankind. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about them that you were calling people to good, ordering the good and forbidding the evil. So if Allah deprives us from this great virtue, then this is a punishment. Let's not think that we are okay and we are good and we're in a situation where we don't care to order the good and forbid the evil. This is a very great punishment from Allah for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can disguise you and hate you and punish you to the degree that you will feel no zeal, no desire to do this great action, and that is ordering the good and forbidding the evil. The Sheikh went on mentioning the explanation of Allama al-Alusi rahimahullah. After saying ordering the good and forbidding the evil, he said also the innovations when they come out. You will see the innovation and you will feel no zeal, no desire to say anything. You see, and actually speaking out against innovations and trying your best to stop them, this is, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, one of the greatest forms of jihad, as long as you do it the right way, you see. So to be deprived of such virtues, of such obligations that you have to be deprived from fulfilling them, this is a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the fitna. It's a big fitna. It's a great punishment.
Benefits of adhering to the principles. Sheikh Salih bin Abdulaziz al-Sheikh writes, observing the principles and fundamentals protects the thoughts, opinions of a Muslim from being affected by those ideas and views which the Sharia does not approve of, restricts the thoughts of a Muslim to the values and ethics of the Sharia. It is known that if a Muslim were to let loose his thoughts without any principles and rules to base his thoughts upon, then his mind will wander in different directions with regards to his behavior, family, society, or generation. This shows us the importance of observing those principles and rules, since it restricts a Muslim's opinion from which stem his behavior concerning his own self, his family, and society.
This is the first advantage, that knowing those rules which he is going to mention, gives you the right framework to act, you see. And this is very important, because for those who are ignorant of those rules and fundamentals, they have no boundary. So they replace those rules and fundamentals with ignorance, with emotions, you see. And anyone who doesn't know the true fundamentals, he has to replace them with fundamentals of his own, you see. He thinks that these are the fundamentals. These are not fundamentals. Fundamentals are the ones which are supported by the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and are agreed upon by the scholars of Al-Sunnah. These are the fundamentals. Otherwise, they would not be called fundamentals and rules. So it's very important. This is one of the great advantages. That's why he made it the first advantage, is By knowing those rules and fundamentals, you are restricted within a certain framework. And within that framework, you can say and you can do. If you don't know those fundamentals and you set your own fundamentals, then the framework will be different, you see.
First principle. When fitan arise and situations change, then one should act with kindness, deliberation, and without haste.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إن الرفق ما كان في شيء إلا زانه ومن تزع من شيء إلا شانه. Rifq, which is gentleness, whenever it is in something, in some action, in whatever anything, then it will beautify it, it will make it good. And if gentleness is taken out of that statement that you say or action that you do, then it will make it bad. The whole action will look like bad and evil. Okay. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah yu'ti 'ala ar-rifq ma la yu'ti 'ala ghayrihi." And he said, "Inna Allah rafiqun yuhibbu ar-rifq." That Allah rewards for your actions that involve gentleness more than he rewards for your actions without it. And that Allah's name is Ar-Rafiq, and his attribute is that he is Rafiq, he is kind, he is gentle, and therefore he loves gentleness. This is a general thing, like for example when Aisha radiallahu anha was a young girl and she was the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and some Jews used to say salam to the Prophet in a wrong way. They used to say assamu alaik, not assalam, assam. Assam means death. So that's the opposite of peace. Yani. Aisha paid attention and she heard him say this. So she got very angry and she said, wa alaykum assam wa la'natullah, and this and that. You know, death be upon you and the curse of Allah is upon you. The Prophet ﷺ turned his face to her and he said, Ya Aisha, إِنَّ الرِّفْقَ مَا كَانَ فِي شَيْءٍ إِلَّا زَانَهُ وَمَنْ تُزِعَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا شَانَهُ. She said, but they are saying such. He said, yes. And I said, wa alaykum. The same be upon you. خلاص. So, when we want to give da'wah to a kafir, for example, we don't tell him, look, you are a kafir. You are a mushrik. So we want to show you tawheed and we want to show you Islam. No, this is not the right way. Okay. You don't have to tell him you are a kafir and you are a mushrik. You say, mashallah, I see you, yani, some person who is looking for the truth. You say something which makes him open his heart for you. You see. You don't even start by attacking his religion. You see, oh, your religion, Christianity, it has a lot of contradictions, this. He will not be ready to listen to you. All he will be thinking is how to defend his religion. You see, but you start by showing him how our faith in Allah is. He will listen. Something new, he wants to know. You see. You show him Islam. You see, that's the way the Prophet ﷺ used to tell the mushriks and kafirs when they were asking him, oh Muhammad, what are you calling to? He said, I'm calling to this. You see. So this is the point, that gentleness is good in everything. And in times of afflictions, gentleness is needed more. You see, just because you are in an affliction, that doesn't mean you should forget gentleness and become rough and this. No. Gentleness is the right way The first thing that should occur to your mind is gentleness, because it will keep your mind يعني straight. But if you start with anger and rage, you will not be you will not be pure thinking. You will not be pure minded. Your thinking will be distorted, you see. Wisdom, mashallah, there are great actions with wisdom. The hadith that we mentioned where the Prophet ﷺ dealt with the Bedouin that were narrated in the masjid. Great wisdom, okay. This is an example that the author has mentioned also. When the Prophet ﷺ knew how Kaaba was built originally by Prophet Ibrahim ﷺ. But he used wisdom and he said, I will not tear it down and rebuild it according to what Ibrahim built it. Because if I do so, those Arabs now, they cannot process this action. They will not understand it. It might be something which will make them doubt and maybe hate the Prophet ﷺ, you see. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ left it. He didn't do it. And when some companion did it in the time of the Umayyad Khilafah, great chaos occurred. Because this companion, when he destroyed the Kaaba and built it according to the way Ibrahim did it, the next Khalifa came and he destroyed it again and he brought it back to where it was before. So then another Khalifa came and wanted to bring it back to the other way. The scholar, I think Imam Malik or someone else, he told him, don't do it, because this will be a game. Every day one will come and destroy it to build it in the way he thinks is right. So they left it, alhamdulillah. Now, this is a very good also example. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was the Prophet ﷺ was hurt by some hypocrites who accused his wife of adultery, fornication, and things like that, he did not kill them. Why? Because outwardly, apparently, they were Muslims by name. By heart, they were kafirs, hypocrites. So the Prophet ﷺ said, if I kill them, then it will be spread that whenever the companions of Muhammad differ with him, he kills them. What kind of religion is this? And they take it as a way to excuse themselves not to follow the Prophet ﷺ. Okay? So the Prophet ﷺ did not kill them for this reason. Not because he doesn't deserve, he deserves it. But the Prophet ﷺ did not kill him for this. The hulm, which means calmness and patience, okay? One should be, as we say in Kuwaiti, heavy. His moves should not be jumping quickly and doing like children. So this is very necessary, hulm. And also hulum means for someone who forgives, he doesn't get angry and revenges and everything, no. He becomes very patient and forgiving, like Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he was this. And when we come to hastiness, the biggest problem nowadays is hastiness, actually. In all the fitnas, if you see any fitna which occurs, you go and follow some of what is being said and written. You will find the hastiness. They jump into doing things, okay? And this is not the way. The scholars of Ahl-Sunnah sometimes need a lot of time to decide, you see. Umar radiallahu anhu, one of the companions said, you people give judgments in issues that Umar radiallahu anhu was collecting all the companions to consult about that issue. And you give it just like that, that easy. So, yani, hastening, this is not the way of the scholars. Anyone who jumps quickly and says, he will, yani, if he fears Allah, he will change his mind next day or even before. So that doesn't look good. It looks shaky, you see. One has to be very considerate of studying the situation and thoroughly and being patient and look, seeing the outcomes and things like this.
Sheikh Saleh bin Abdulaziz Al Sheikh mentions the following narration under the first principle while explaining Hulm, tolerance, deliberation. It is recorded in Sahih Muslim that Mustawrad Al-Qurashi reported, I heard Allah's messenger saying, the last hour would come while the Romans would form majority of people. Amr said to him, be careful of what you say. He replied, I say what I heard from Allah's messenger. Thereupon, Amr said, if it is so, then that is due to four qualities that the Romans possess. They are the most deliberate people upon emergence of fitan. They are the quickest of people to recover after a calamity. They are quick to recover and attack again after defeat. And they are good to the poor, orphans and the weak. And a fifth good quality that they have is that they resist the oppression of kings.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Halim, as the brother mentioned. And Allah loves for us to act upon His morals, His qualities, okay? Not all of them, not Al-Mutakabbir and things like that, no. But things which are special of Him, we don't. But Al-Halim, Al-Rahim, and qualities like that, we act upon those qualities ourselves. So here, there is a hadith about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioning one of the signs of the Day of Judgment, or mentioning that when the signs of the Day of Judgment come, the final signs, the Romans will be most of the people. Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu told the one who was narrating this, he said, be watchful of what you say. This is just to make him aware that he should be accurate and not narrate anything. So the Mustawrid said, why shouldn't I say what the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said? So he was sure. Okay. And then he said, Amr ibn al-As said, if that's the situation, then the Romans have four qualities. First, the hulm, the tolerance, especially in the time of fitna. And second, they have the fastest awakeness after a hazard and after a calamity. They awake quickly. They recover quickly. And then he mentioned the four qualities, and he made them five, I think. He mentioned five qualities. So this is something where Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu is mentioning that this is one of the reasons for this nation to last that long and to be most of the people. You see? This is praising this quality, which is al-hulm. Because opposite to al-hulm is to be hasty and to be jumping to actions, without patience. And this leads to a lot of troubles, you see. It leads to a lot of killing, a lot of trouble, a lot of loss, you see. While the Prophet ﷺ is saying the Romans will still be there until the signs of the Day of Judgment, and they will be most of the people. Yes, we can follow whatever is good in them, no problem. It's already in our religion. We don't have to go and look at their books and at them to find what is good. It's already in our religion. We mentioned the hadith about hulum, tolerance. Resisting the oppression of the kings has levels. In Islam, our sharia allows certain levels and not all levels, you see. The resistance could be by advice. And this is allowed in Islam. Yeah, this is advice, and advice gently between you and him. As the Prophet ﷺ said, if you see something which you dislike from your Amir, then hold his hand, say salam or something, and then tell him between you and him secretly. And this was applied by the companions. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, as narrated by Sahih al-Bukhari, when he saw an innovation by one of the Umayyad Khalifs, he came early to be close to the prince, and he stayed in the first line where the prince comes and says his khutbah. Okay? When he came, he stood up, Abu Sa'id, and he shook hands with him, just like the Prophet said, and he hugged him. And while he was hugging him, he was telling him that what you are doing is an innovation to make the khutbah of Eid before Salat. Okay. The prince said, I know, but yani, I'm still doing it. For politics, yani. Okay. And Abu Sa'id sat down.
The prohibition of speaking about the faults and mistakes of the rulers. Explanation by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan.
سائل آخر يقول ما هو توجيهكم لمن يتكلم في عيوب أخطاء الولاة في المجالس الخاصة والعامة وخاصة إذا كان من المعلمين والمعلمات والموجهين والموجهات والخطباء وبعض الدعاة؟
هذا منهج الخوارج الذي يسب الولاة ويذكر عيوبهم بالمجالس أو على المنابر، هذا مذهب الخوارج. الخوارج ما خرجوا إلا بسبب هذا، لما فشى سب ولي الأمر في عهد عثمان رضي الله عنه أهل الأمر إلى الفتنة والعياذ بالله، وقتل الخليفة الراشد. وكذلك ما من جاء بعده يتسبب عن هذا شق عصا الطاعة، ويتسبب عنه القتل والقتيل وتفكك الكلمة، فهذا يعتبر من المفسدين. فعليه أن يتوب إلى الله عز وجل ولا يكون من المفسدين، بل يكون من المصلحين الداعين إلى الله جل وعلا على بصيرة، الداعين إلى جمع الكلمة، الداعين إلى التآلف، الداعين إلى عدم الناهين عن التفرق والاختلاف. هو عنده عيوب، لماذا ينسى عيوبه ويذكر عيوب ولي الأمر؟ عليه أن يصلح نفسه هو أولا إذا كان أنه يكره العيوب. نعم.
Disobedience of the people to Allah reflects in their rulers. Explanation by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Saleh ibn al-Uthaymeen.
يسرنا ما قاله السائل في أن في قلوب الناس للعلماء مكانة، لأن الناس لا يزالون في خير ما عظموا ولاة أمورهم، اتباعا لقول الله تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم. أولو الأمر منا هم العلماء والأمراء، أما العلماء فهم أولو الأمر في شرع الله، يبينونه للأمة ويوضحونه لهم وينشرونه بينهم. وأما الأمراء فهم أولو الأمر المنفذون لأمر الله، الملزمون لعباد الله به. ولهذا كان مرجع أولو الأمر من الأمراء إلى أولي الأمر من العلماء، إذ أن الأمراء إذا ساروا بدون العلماء فقد يضلون ضلالا بعيدا، وإذا لم يأخذوا بما دل عليه شريعة الله، بما دلت عليه شريعة الله أو بما جاءت به شريعة الله، إذا لم يأخذوا بما جاءت به شريعة الله فإن معصية الناس لهم تكون بقدر معصيتهم لله. وهذه نقطة يجب أن نتفطن لها. معصية الناس لولاة الأمور بقدر معصية ولاة الأمور لله عز وجل. فكلما أطاع ولاة الأمور ربهم أخضع الله لهم قلوب الناس وأطاعوه ولم يتمردوا عليه. فمن اتقى الله في من ولاه الله عليه اتقاه من ولاهم الله عليه، والعكس بالعكس. ويذكر أن عبد الملك بن مروان لما رأى تمرد الناس عليه جمع أشراف الناس وخطبهم وقال لهم: إنكم تريدون منا أن نكون لكم كأبي بكر وعمر، فأنتم كونوا لنا كرجال أبي بكر وعمر فنكون لكم كأبي بكر وعمر. وجاء رجل من الخوارج إلى علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه فقال له: يا علي، ما بال الناس خرجوا عليك ولم يخرجوا على أبي بكر وعمر؟ فقال له: لأن رجالي أنت وأمثالك، ورجال أبي بكر أنا وأمثالي. فألقمه حجرا. فالمهم أن ولاة الأمر إذا كانوا مرجع الناس فإن الناس في خير، أما إذا تمرد الناس عن ولاة الأمر فخالفوا العلماء بغير علم وتمردوا على الحكام فذلك عنوان الشقاء في هؤلاء وهؤلاء. فالواجب علينا احترام ولاة الأمور من العلماء واحترام ولاة أمورنا من الأمراء، وأن نبذل لهم النصيحة. وبذل النصيحة ليس هو الفضيحة على رؤوس المنابر وفي المجالس العامة في تتبع مساوئهم، قال العالم فلان كذا وكذا وقد أخطأ، يعني بعض الناس قال العالم فلان كذا وكذا وقد أخطأ وهذا غلط، فعلت الدولة كذا وكذا وقد أخطأت، هذا ليس من النصيحة في شيء. النصيحة أن تتصل بالمخطئ إما بواسطة أو بغير واسطة وتبين له خطأ، فقد يكون مع المناقشة يتبين للجميع الصواب، إما أن يكون الصواب معك فيرجع إليك، وإما أن يكون معه فترجع إليه، وإما أن يكون كل منكم له وجهة نظر يعذره فيها الآخر. وأما من وراء جدر يقع الناس في أعراض العلماء أو يقعون في أعراض الأمراء فإن هذا لا شك عنوان على التفرق وتمزق الأمة. فإذا كان كما قال السائل وفقه الله للعلماء مكانة في قلوب الناس فهذا عنوان الخير والسعادة، ونرجو أن يكون في قلوب الناس أيضا مكانة أن يكون في قلوبهم مكانة لولاة الأمر من الأمراء، وأن يناصحوهم وأن يعلموا أنهم بشر ليسوا معصومين من الخطأ، هم يخطئون كما يخطئ البشر. أنت الآن في بيتك ألست تخطئ في تربية أولادك؟ إذن هم قد يخطئون مع أن دائرة عملهم أوسع من دائرة عمل البيت، عمل البيت محصور، لكن ولاة الأمور دائرة عملهم واسعة جدا. لهذا أقول إن من نعمة الله على الأمة أن يكون بينهم وبين ولاة أمور من العلماء والأمراء مودة واتصال ومناصحة، وعلى كل من تبين له الحق من هؤلاء وهؤلاء أن يرجع إليه، لأن الله يقول: فإن تنازعتم بشيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا.
Second principle. When fitan arise and situations change, then do not give judgment about anything except after fully grasping the situation.
ولا تقف ما ليس لك به علم. Do not follow that which you have no knowledge of. And also the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in which he said, من حسن إسلام المرء تركه ما لا يعنيه. It is from the good sign of the faith of a Muslim that he doesn't follow something which he has no concern of for, or something that doesn't concern him. And this falls under the same meaning of the verse, because backbiting doesn't concern you. You don't indulge in backbiting. You see, lying doesn't concern you. It's not beneficial for your faith. It's none of your business to lie or to backbite. Similarly, to say something without knowledge, you have not fully grasped the situation. So don't rush to decisions and rulings and, you know, based on partial knowledge, or sometimes based on false knowledge. You see, a lot of people now, when they hear some kind of news in the one of those satellites, whatever they are, okay, it becomes as a fact to them immediately. How could you do this? This is, you have to make sure of this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. If a fasiq, someone who is sinning openly, comes to you with a news, then you have to make sure. You have to be sure. You cannot just accept it right away, you see. And we have satellites now. This satellite is concentrating on the situation on a certain country, while the other satellite, which has the same capabilities and can do the same thing, is neglecting the same situation altogether. You see, so which one is to believe, this or this? Or not even neglecting it altogether, but saying the opposite of that, what the other one is saying, you see. This satellite is saying something in favor of the situation all the day. Okay, and this satellite is doing the opposite all the day. Is this something which a Muslim should be fooled by? No. One has to make sure what those people are saying and what the others are saying, and then go and make sure. You don't have to give a judgment. And who are you to give a judgment? Wait, there are scholars. There are scholars who, upon receiving the information, they double check it, they have their ways, they wait, they weigh the statements in the right way, and they weigh the outcomes of the decisions that they are going to make in the right way, you see.
When the ignorant speak about fitan, the fitan increase. Explanation by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan.
الفتن لا يتكلم فيها إلا أهل العلم والبصير، ما هو كل يتكلم فيها. إذا تكلم الجهال في الفتن زادت الفتن، أما إذا تكلم فيها العلماء وبينوها فإنها تطفى بإذن الله. فالفتن ما يتكلم فيها كل أحد، وإنما يتكلم فيها أهل العلم وأهل البصيرة الذين يعرفون الحق من الباطل ويعرفون كيف يتكلمون. ما يخوض كل واحد في الفتن ويتكلم ويفتي ويقول. نعم.
Why are scholars silent at the occurrence of some incidents?
نسمع بعض طلبة العلم أحيانا يطعنون في العلماء بحجة أنهم يسكتون عند حصول بعض الحوادث أو عند حلول بعض النوازل، فما هو تعليقكم يا فضيلة الشيخ؟
أحيانا يكون السكوت هو المصلحة، وأحيانا يكون الكلام هو المصلحة. فالعلماء يراعون المصالح ودرء المفاسد، فلا يتكلمون إلا حيث يفيد الكلام وينفع، ولا يسكتون إلا حيث يكون السكوت أولى. فالعلماء بالمعنى الصحيح لا يسكتون إلا إذا كان السكوت له مجال، ولا يتكلمون إلا إذا كان الكلام له مجال. والأمور إذا حدثت لا يصلح لكل واحد أن يتكلم فيها، وإنما توكل لأهل العلم وأهل الرأي وأهل الكلمة، كما قال جل وعلا: وإذا جاءهم أمر من الأمن أو الخوف أذاعوا به ولو ردوه إلى الرسول وإلى أولي الأمر منهم لعلمه الذين يستنبطونه منهم. فالأمور التي تتعلق بمصالح المسلمين وبالأمة هذه لا يتولاها إلا أهل الحل والعقد، أهل العلم والبصيرة الذين يلتمسون لها الحلول الصحيحة. وأما أن يتولاها ويتكلم فيها كل ما هب ودب، فهذا من الضرر على المسلمين ومن الإرجاف والتخويف، ولا يصل المسلمون من وراء ذلك إلى نتيجة. وهذه أيضا أمور قد تكون أمورا سرية تعالج بالسرية، ولا تعالج علانية أمام الناس، وإنما تعالج مع السرية ومع الطرق الصحيحة. الأمور تحتاج إلى روية وإلى تعقل، والواجب على العامة أن يرجعوا إلى أهل العلم وأهل الرأي والبصيرة في هذه الأمور.
So this is very important actually, is that a Muslim should not rush to speak about something, especially if it is something which involves bloodshed and a lot of things, you know, then if you say a word improperly, then as if you have supported bloodshedding, and you will be one of those who are accountable for killing this person or that person, you see. And that's why some of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam abstained from many actions during the fitna. As a matter of fact, one of them was asked just to say his opinion. He said, no, I don't want to say something with no knowledge which leads to killing a Muslim. I'll be responsible for killing that Muslim. You see? So this is something that the Muslims have to understand. This is some of the great morals and great fundamentals that we should know and understand. And if you don't speak, you will not be responsible. But if you speak wrongly, you will be responsible. You see? The only time where you will be responsible if you don't speak, if you are sure about the truth and you can participate in correcting the situation and you don't do it, then you will be responsible. But if you are not sure, then it's better to be quiet. It's an obligation to be quiet. You cannot say something without visioning the situation correctly. The Sheikh here says a good rule in Sharia, that's al-hukmu ala al-shay far'un an tasawwurihi. To judge in any issue, this comes as a result of visioning the situation. The ruling, what you are going to say about the situation, must be preceded by the correct vision. Allah says about the scholars, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَى. It's only those it's only those who are scholars who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone is a scholar, then he fears Allah. He will not give a fatwa without picturing the situation, you see. No scholar would dare to give a fatwa about any issue without knowing a picture about it. If he doesn't know the picture about it, if he doesn't know the يعني, details of it, he will tell you, I don't know. I don't know this. I remember so many times Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah was asked and he said, I don't know. And this is يعني, something which comes out of piousness and out of fear of Allah. The ignorant gives a fatwa very easily. Oh, Sheikh, how is it? Is it okay to go and kill those people? Oh, yeah, it's okay. Okay, inshallah. Mashallah. As if murdering a Muslim or even murdering a kafir or a cat or whatever, as if it's something easy. It's not easy, a'udhu billah. Destroying the Kaaba is easier in the sight of Allah than shedding the blood of a Muslim. Destroying the Kaaba, you see, as narrated in the true hadith. So how could someone just give a fatwa like that? I remember once in 1992 or something, one of the so-called da'is was asked about what's going on in Algiers at that time. If we do this, a lot of people will be killed by the government and things. He said, okay, fi sabilillah, what's wrong? 5,000 die for the sake of Allah? Subhanallah. Is it that cheap for you? The blood of Muslims, are that cheap for you? 5,000. He says, it's okay. It's okay. So, the scholars really know, fearing Allah, they don't give a fatwa if they don't know enough to give a fatwa, you see. Every fatwa has two pillars. One is the knowledge of the situation itself, fiqh al-waqi', and one is the knowledge of sharia regarding the ruling for that situation. So the scholar will not answer except by knowing enough about the situation. What the details? He might not need a lot of details like you or me, but at least he should know enough.
Concerning those who say, scholars do not know the current affairs. Explanation by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan.
يقول السائل يكثر الآن كلام بعض الناس يقولون عليكم في المشايخ الذين عايشوا الواقع هذا وعليكم بهم لأنهم أعرف في الواقع وفقه من كبار علمائنا هل هذه المقولة صحيحة؟
كيف كانوا كبار علماء وهم ما يعرفون الواقع؟ لا يكون من كبار العلماء إلا من يعرف الواقع وينزل الحوادث على الأدلة ويعرف حكمها، هذا الذي يكون من كبار العلماء. أما الذي لا يعرف الواقع فهذا ليس من كبار العلماء. ففيه تناقض، هذا الكلام فيه تناقض. لا يكون من كبار العلماء إلا من عرف الكتاب والسنة وعرف الواقع وطبق الواقع على الأدلة وعرف حكمها، هذا هو الذي يكون من أهل العلم ومن كبار العلماء. أما الذي لا يعرف إلا الواقع فقط ولا يعرف الكتاب والسنة فهذا ليس عنده علم. كثير من الناس يعرفون اللي يجري في العالم من الحروب ويعرفون ما يصدر من الناس وما، لكن ما يعرفون حكمها في الشرع، ما يعرفون حكمها، عندهم اطلاع على ما يجري لكن ليس عندهم معرفة بالعلوم الشرعية. فهذا لا يلتفت إلى كلامه، لو كان عنده علم ما قال هذه المقالة، ما قال هذه المقالة إلا لأنه لا يعرف قدر العلماء، وإنما عنده أن العلماء هم الذين يطلعون على ما يجري في الناس من الحروب ومن السياسات ومن ومن، ويتركون طلب العلم ويتركون الرجوع إلى كتاب الله وسنة رسوله.
So those who accuse the scholars of giving a fatwa not knowing the situation, they are actually they are either innovators who don't love our scholars, or they are so ignorant that they are full of false pride in themselves, you know. It's not easy to declare a scholar ignorant just like that, you know. How do you know that he did not know the situation? Just because his fatwa is not like what you want, you immediately assumed that he doesn't know? Ya akhi, fear Allah. You cannot accuse the scholar by this, you see. If you are in doubt of his knowledge about the situation, then call him. Go to him. Alhamdulillah, the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah, their doors are open. They don't close their doors, neither in their work nor in their homes. Their telephone is there. Their email is there now. Their sites on the internet are there now, you see. So you have no excuse. Go and show them what they miss of the situation. Tell them. If you feel that their knowledge is short, go and tell them, you see. This is not the right way. It's most probably those who say those things about our scholars, they hate our scholars. They hate them. And especially those who classify scholars who work with the government to be puppets of the government. Okay? They want the Muslim government to have devils around them instead of scholars of Al-Sunnah, as if that will solve the situation and make it better. Subhanallah. How could you hate that scholars be amongst those who give advice to the government? And this is, alhamdulillah, this will, it doesn't wipe out all the evil, it will reduce the evil so much, you see. When the Bedouin came to the masjid, and the masjid at that time was all sand, nothing, no rugs, nothing. So the Bedouin took one corner inside the mosque and he started to urinate. Okay? He doesn't know. He just became a Muslim and he thought it's okay. This is sand and outside it's sand. So he didn't know. So he started urinating. Some of the companions were about to go and grab him and forbid him, by force and things like that. The Prophet ﷺ said, no, leave him. Leave him, let him finish. Why? This is farsightness. This is wisdom. Because if this man was chased by the companions, naturally he will make more area dirty by running away, you see. This is one thing. So you have not done any good, okay. The second thing, he might think that what kind of religion is this that forbids urination? And he might run away for good and not even become a Muslim, okay. And that's why when he saw this attitude of the Prophet ﷺ towards him, when he finished, he came to the Prophet ﷺ saying, oh Allah, be merciful to me and to Muhammad and not to anyone else. Don't be merciful
to all those people. Because he's ignorant. He just came in Islam and he doesn't know. So the Prophet ﷺ told him the masjids must be clean and so on and so on. He taught him nicely and he was very happy by this. And it solved the situation, you see. Nowadays, if a situation like this arises, oh my goodness. Yani, if they have an RPG, they'll use it with him. Yani, I'm serious. Yani, I remember when years ago something happened in Gaza, the Jews were doing something and a lot of trouble was there. And I was following one of those sites in the internet. One person said, we should go and hijack an Israeli plane or an American plane or any plane and bomb Israel. And you find suggestions like this. People just follow emotions, pure emotions, you see. And they don't think of the outcomes. They don't think, if you go and bomb them, and then what? Then what? This will be an excuse for them to revenge, you know, and do 100 times worse things than they were doing before. And you cannot do anything. All you will do is cry and shout and cuss. And that's all. And then also here, the Sheikh says, you use this rule in your ordinary matters. And in all kinds of different situations that you go through. Yani, it's nothing new, yani. Everyone, even the intellectuals from any religion use this, you know. They don't speak out of speculation and all this. No, they speak out of surety. They know the situation and they base their judgment on that.
Third principle. The Muslim must abide by justice and fairness in all issues.
This is the concept of being just. And this is one of the clear fundamentals in the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in his book, إن الله يأمر بالعدل. Allah orders you to be just. And this is for all people. And you have to be just with all people. Not only with people, even with animals, even with plants, even with... You have to be just, you see. You cannot come and bring some kind of acid and throw it in the plant. You think this is okay? No, it's not okay. You have to be just. You see, you cannot, because a dog barked outside, you bring a big stone and blow his head up or break his leg, you know. You have to be just. So how about humans? You have to be just. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man aadha dhimmiyan lam yarih raihat al-jannah." A dhimmi is a Christian or Jew who lives in an Islamic state under the Muslim's protection. The Prophet ﷺ says, if you hurt him, not if you kill him, if you hurt him, you will not smell the smell of paradise. This is a great threat. The smell of paradise, according to some hadiths, is from 40 years distance. And according to some hadiths, is more than that. This doesn't mean you will become kafir and you will never enter paradise. This is, according to the way of Ahlul Sunnah, this is to show how ugly this sin is. You see? And here the Prophet ﷺ is talking about Christians and Jews. You cannot hurt them in an unjust way. You see? You cannot hurt them in an unjust way. So how about hurting Muslims? you see, like we see nowadays. People hurt Muslims by all kinds of ways, not only rulers and all people. You see, all kinds of people. You find someone has his music in his car so loud, okay? He is hurting a lot of Muslims, you see, who know that this is haram, okay? And it hurts them to hear it, okay? And it hurts them more. They cannot say anything to you, because if they say something, you will bark at them, you know, and you will shout at them, okay? So, this is justice in Islam. This is justice. And the Sheikh here is applying it to this subject, that sometimes when you search for the information, or you give the picture, describe the picture of the situation, don't miss out the bad things, the evil things. When you come to a scholar and you want him to give you a fatwa regarding a certain situation, don't come and give the scholar only what they think helps their side, the answer they want. So they fix their question in a way that they benefit only from. This is cheating. This is unjust. Okay. You have to mention the full picture, the good and bad. Let's say, for example, entering the so-called parliaments, whether it's here in our country or in any other country. Some people went to Sheikh bin Baz and Sheikh bin Uthaymeen and others, and they said, if we so-called Islamists don't enter those parliaments, then only the deviants will enter and only the liberals will enter, and they will create a lot of corruption in the country and all this. The scholar took them for their word, and he said, no, in this case, you can enter. As a matter of fact, Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen got so enthusiastic, he said, you must enter. You cannot let those people who do corruption and this. But if they can't come and tell the scholar, in order for us to succeed in those elections, we have to do some kind of lying. We have to do some kind of cheating. We have to be giving some false promises that we know we cannot fulfill. We have to use tribehood. We have to use nationalism. We have to say democracy and all that garbage. I don't think the scholar will give them the same fatwa, you see. But they didn't say any of this, you see. None of this, they said. They only said what they think it's going to help them, you see. And what they think the scholar will answer them the way they like. You see, they want to get a fatwa from them, and that's it. That's all they want. And believe it or not, if they didn't get it from them, they will go to someone else until they find someone who gives them. Okay? So this is the point, that one has to be just. Just in judging the people. If you criticize someone, okay, even if he's a kafir, you don't hide something good in him. If you have to mention it, go ahead and mention it. Okay, if you reply on an innovator, for example, it's not a rule always that you leave out all the evil that is in this innovator. It's not a rule that you never mention any of his goods. And anyone who says this doesn't understand the right way and doesn't understand the way of the scholars. I remember Samahat Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, when he replied on one of the most deviant heads nowadays. He propagates shirk, great shirk, in his books and in his speeches. Okay? The Sheikh, his writing, his article is on his site. Okay? The Sheikh started by calling him Fadilatu Sheikh, Honorable Sheikh. Okay? Because he is well known by his people, and that's what they call him. Okay? So he used that. And then he criticized him. He said, what you said here, this is great shirk. You see, great shirk. Because he said it's okay to supplicate to the awliya or something like that. So he said, it's shirk. Sheikh bin Baz said, this is great shirk. Supplication to the dead is great shirk. And then he mentioned other things regarding the innovation of the maulid of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the Sheikh brought the proofs that this is an innovation and this is wrong and all that. And then he said to him, regarding what you said about the story of the seerah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and this, may Allah reward you, I have benefited a lot from this. I'm sure it's not new to the Sheikh, but he is just saying this to him. You see, I have benefited a lot from it. You see, this is not the way of a lot of people nowadays who claim to be Salafis and, you know, in their way of replying on others. This is not their way. You see, when they attack someone, even if he is from Ahlus Sunnah and he made a mistake, they completely burn him. You see, this is not the way of Ahlus Sunnah. And this is not justice, okay? How do you like that people treat you like that? If you make a mistake, then all of them all of a sudden turn against you and burn you out. This is not the way. Especially when you are dealing with scholars. The Abdullah ibn Abbas, the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also Mu'adh ibn Jabal, another companion, they said, اتقوا زيغة الحكيم ولا يصدنكم ذلك عن علمه. This is a very beautiful statement. اتقوا زيغة الحكيم. الحكيم, the wise, meaning the scholar of Ahlul Sunnah. Avoid his mistake, but لا يصدنكم ذلك عن علمه. Don't let your avoiding that mistake make you يعني abandon him completely. This is unjust. And if you do this, then no scholar is infallible. The scholars make mistakes, okay? So if someone makes a mistake, you abandon him, خلاص. You see how this is? So for this issue also, we need the justice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يجرمنكم شنآن قوم على أن تعدلوا على أن لا تعدلوا اعدلوا هو أقرب إلى التقوى. If you hate some people, if you think they are bad, don't do injustice to them. You see, hating them or thinking that they have deviations should not be an excuse for you to be unjust to them. You see. Now